So the next type of addition reaction we want to look at is a hydrohalogenation. From the name, we could expect that it is a hydrogen and a halogen that are the two groups being added to the carbons in the double bond. So this time, let's actually look at the mechanism. And what we need to understand about addition reactions is that what we're seeing now is that a pi bond can behave as a nucleophile. It is electron density that is polarizable, and so it can attack an electron deficient something or other, like a proton. So here goes the pi bond going to attack that proton, and then those electrons stay with the bromine. So now here's the question. There are two possibilities here. You can almost think of it, it's not terribly accurate, but you can think of it as this pi bond sort of swinging out like a trap door one way or the other. Now, is it the case that the hydrogen will end up bound to this carbon, meaning that this carbon would lose an electron domain and be left with a carbocation? Or is it the case that it will swing out this way so that the hydrogen would be attached to this carbon, leaving a carbocation over here? Well, once again, we know that the more substituted a carbocation is, the more stable it's going to be. And so for that reason, we're exclusive going to get the secondary carbocation. So this proton, which is now implied, is attached to this carbon down here, because if that is the way it goes, we're going to get the more stable carbocation intermediate. So that's where that's going to, we're going to get the carbocation there, and then the bromide from before, very easy, negative charge is attracted to a positive charge, and we're going to get our alkyl bromide. Now, we have to learn a new term here, because what we're seeing is that whereas with the hydrogenation we were highlighting a kind of stereospecificity, meaning the discrepancy between two groups being added from the same side or from opposite sides, but now, whereas this is not stereospecific, because remember that this is just like basically like an SN1 reaction at the end of it here, we have a carbocation, and then that bromide, that incoming nucleophile, can approach from either side. And if we were generating a chiral product, we would get a racemic mixture. But whereas there is no stereospecificity, there is something called regiospecificity. Now that's because these are the two bond, these are the two carbons participating in that pi bond, and so it should follow that any nucleophile that's going to attach, like a bromine or something, whichever is the more significant of the two groups, it could either end up on the less substituted carbon, or it could end up on the more substituted carbon. In the case where that nucleophile ends up on the more substituted carbon, you have what's called a Markovnikov product. Now that is a kind of regiospecificity. So this is a Markovnikov hydrohalogenation reaction, because that halogen atom ends up on the more substituted of the two carbons that were participating in the double bond, right? Primary, secondary, secondary is more substituted. Now, there's ways to get the anti-Markovnikov product. So in this case, running this reaction in the presence of peroxides will promote the anti-Markovnikov product. Now the mechanism is a little bit more complicated and it involves radicals, so we'll look at that another time. But for the moment, we just need to understand that when run in the presence of peroxides, that will promote anti-Markovnikov regiospecificity. So once again, just to reiterate, we need to understand that there can be stereospecificity, which would yield a syn or anti-stereospecificity within a reaction, and there's also regiospecificity, which means the difference between where a functional group could end up on the product. And any addition reaction may or may not be one or both of these things. So with the hydrogenation, we saw stereospecificity, but not regiospecificity. Whereas with hydrohalogenation, we can see that there is not stereospecificity, but there is regiospecificity. The next addition reaction we want to take a look at is acid-catalyzed hydration. So once again, we're going to see that the pi bond behaves as the nucleophile and the proton as the electrophile. And so this is the same first step basically as the hydrohalogenation. So we're seeing that we once again have two options for where the carbocation could end up, and it will exclusively end up on the secondary carbon because it's more stable. And then the difference here is that a water molecule could attack instead of the bromide or the halide. Now we have water there. This does have a formal positive charge there on the oxygen. And then maybe another molecule of water can deprotonate this one, neutralize that, and we have our secondary alcohol. So just like the hydrohalogenation, we're seeing that acid-catalyzed hydration is a regio-specific reaction. It is going to yield a Markovnikov product for the same reasons as the hydrohalogenation. Once again, we're seeing that the regio-specificity is directed by the stability, the differing stabilities of potential carbocation intermediates. Now, what's interesting about acid-catalyzed hydration is it's exactly the opposite of the acid-catalyzed dehydration that we saw during the carbocation rearrangement. We can imagine protonating this oxygen and getting to here, and then water leaving, giving us this carbocation, and then an elimination occurring. So we can see that a lot of these mechanisms are reciprocal and related and depend on certain aspects of equilibria to see which way they're being driven. So the last addition reaction we want to look at is dihalogenation. As you could guess, this is where two halogen atoms are attached to the two carbons participating in the double bond. So once again, we're going to see the pi bond behaving as the nucleophile, so that's nothing new. And while it would seem a little bit strange that a nonpolar bromine molecule could behave as the electrophile, it's just simply the case that bromine atoms are pretty large, and so this electron cloud is pretty polarizable. So a pi bond can generate enough of a momentary dipole on a bromine molecule that one of the atoms can become slightly partially positive, and now you have an electrophile. So what we end up getting is this bromonium ion intermediate, which is a little bit strange. It's as though a bromine atom has inserted itself into that pi bond. And so we have a formally positively charged bromine atom, as it's showing six electrons to this Lewis dot structure as opposed to its typical valency of seven. And now each of these carbons is partially positive due to a polar bond to the bromine atom. And so now the second step here, the bromide left over from before, this is basically just going to do a standard SN2 reaction. The only difference is that the leaving group is going to remain tethered to the molecule because it has another bond to another carbon atom over there. So here's our dihalogenation product. So we have our two bromine atoms now on the product there. And because of the stereospecificity inherent in an SN2 reaction right here, being that it must proceed via the backside attack, that makes this an anti-addition reaction. So what we want to be clear about is while there is a kind of stereospecificity in the sense that the second step is a stereospecific SN2 reaction, that's going to give us an absolute configuration of R and S for these two, but it could have been the other way around if the bromine initially added on the other side. As it was, the bromine atom arrived from this direction, but it could have arrived from the other direction, and this bromine could have been on the dash bonds in the intermediate, and then the bromide would have approached from the front. So there are different gradations of stereospecificity, I guess you could say. So there is a kind of stereospecificity. And so just in general, when we're looking at addition reactions, we want to be aware of any possible stereospecificity as well as regiospecificity. So in the case where the two atoms being added are the same or of the same element, we cannot discuss any regiospecificity because it doesn't matter which atom goes where. It's going to be the same structural product, and so there's no regiospecificity here. Or as with the hydration, there was no regiospecificity because it was the hydrogenation because those were two hydrogen atoms. Whereas with the hydrohalogenation and the hydration, there was no stereospecificity because we had carbocation intermediates, but we did have regiospecificity in the form of a Markovnikov or an anti-Markovnikov product, depending on where the hydroxyl or the bromine ended up. So once again, be aware of any regiospecificity or stereospecificity if you want to draw the correct product in an addition reaction. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, and as always, feel free to email me with questions, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.